What's up, everybody? It's your boy JP, back with another hot one. That's right, you already know, you already see it. OnePlus Nord, your boy already has it. Everyone getting the Pixel 4a early except me. I won't get mine until next week, maybe 2 days before the release date, and I will drop a video of it. Well, that's all fine and dandy, because your boy got the OnePlus Nord before most in the U.S., I think. I know it's still on pre-order from a lot of eBay sellers that I typically use, but I got it off of club.co.uk. They already have it. It's a pretty decent price. The pricing fluctuates, though, so let me just put that out there. I've seen the price depending on... this is actually the 12-gig model. They're actually sold out of it, but I've seen the 8-gig model go for, I think, like $450, $460, and that is USD currency, because they do have an option on their website, even though it ships from the UK, and they do originally show the currency as pound. You can change it in the upper right hand corner to USD. Very simple, very easy website to use. I've used them several times, but again, this is the 12 gigabyte variant. 256 gigs internal. It is a fluid AMOLED, 90 hertz refresh rate, full HD plus. It's a 6.44 inch panel. Again, in display fingerprint sensor. Believe it or not, the back is they say it's plastic, and I'll tell you, it doesn't feel like it. It doesn't look like it. It's beautiful. It's absolutely gorgeous. I mean, I you could have had me fooled, but they, you know, it is plastic, and you know, but this is something. This and the Pixel 4a, I wouldn't have a problem paying plastic for. It's the Galaxy Note 20 for $1,000 that I would have a serious problem with paying for when it's freaking plastic. So yeah, keep that in mind. This phone is very unique. I think there's a lot more excitement over this phone than there was the OnePlus 8 series, which I'll get to in a second here. But as I said, quadruple rear camera setup. It has a macro there and an ultra wide angle. Has your dual front facing selfie, kind of like the Moto G 5G Plus has. You know, USB Type C, your speaker, your volume rocker, and got your power button and OnePlus's very famous alert slider. I did not expect them to include this on the Nord. I don't expect them to get rid of it on their flagships, but I did not expect them to include it on you know, their first mid-range in 5 years. As a matter of fact, can anyone tell me if their first and only other mid-range, for that matter, the OnePlus X. Could anyone tell me if that even had an alert slider? Because I never had that phone. If y'all want to hit me up in the comments and let me know, I'm actually asking. It's not a trivia. I really have no clue. I'm wondering. But thought it was pretty cool how they included that with the Nord. It's amazing how when I use a OnePlus phone, I get so used to using that alert slider. And then when I switch to something else, or I switch back to something else, and you know, I send the OnePlus, you know, back, or I sell it, et cetera, et cetera. It's amazing how much I take that alert slider for granted. I mean, they're literally the only Android manufacturer that does that. You know, because when I use an iPhone, for example, you know, it's there. It's always been there. Apple's retained it after all these years. And you know, OnePlus is like the only Android phone you could go to from an iPhone and kind of feel at home with the alert slider for those of you who daily your iPhones. Of course, I don't myself. Anyone that knows me knows that I do keep an iPhone as a secondary phone, but I daily Android. So I don't quite have that problem there. But it's just a really nice touch that, I mean, let's be honest, OnePlus doesn't have to keep. But they do, and I think that's really unique, just really unique there. But there's no headphone jack. Has a metallic build around the side here, Very nice. They blended it very nicely there. There's your SIM tray there, if I didn't go over that. There is no micro SD expansion. But again, those of you that know me know how much I like expandable memory, but it's not a deal breaker. No wireless charging. Again, that's never even been as important to me as a micro SD card slot anyways. But it does have OnePlus's Warp Charge 30T. So this thing will charge in no time. You get your gel case included with it here. You got your got a little pamphlet there, kind of explaining the team and their thoughts for the Nord team. Their thoughts for, you know, kind of going back to their roots, if you will, making an affordable phone, a quality affordable phone. No longer a flagship killer, but I don't know. I don't know, honestly. I'll get to that in a second here. Your stickers, kind of like what Apple does again. Your SIM ejector tool, your booklets, the usual, you know, USB Type-C cable and their typical red color that they use, their red hue, the usual. But let's see if I can catch the brightness on the screen here. It does get very bright. It's a very nice screen. Let me see if I can kind of zoom in and focus on that there a little bit there. There we go. Very nice. This AMOLED panel is what's up. It is super high quality. They definitely spared no expenses when it came to the display. You know, I'm okay with a plastic back because it looks glass still anyways. And, hey, it's less prone to shattering. So, I mean, there you go. And, I mean, you know, I'm not really too worried about getting scratches on it. I doubt I will. I always keep it in the protective case. I love the gel cases that are included with these. A lot of people don't. I do, because I like very minimalistic cases anyways. But it's a unique box. Probably the most unique box I have seen a OnePlus ship in since the OnePlus 6T McLaren that came out almost 2 years ago. That had my favorite box. Still is my favorite OnePlus box, but this Nord box is really nice. They've really paid attention to detail here. This phone has a unique history. Again, let me go over the specs again here. Snapdragon 765G 5G chipset. It is the gaming variant, 765G, not just the 765. It has your quad camera system, dual camera in the front, like the Moto G 5G Plus has that y'all have seen me review. 6.44 inch fluid AMOLED, 90 hertz refresh rate, 1080 Full HD Plus. I got the 12 gigabyte variant, 256 gigs of internal storage. And, you know, let me tell you, I've reviewed a lot of Snapdragon 765 powered phones and I don't even think I've had one that had 8 gigs of RAM. This bad boy has 12 gigs of RAM, 12 gigs. And let me tell you, it is by far the fastest 765 powered phone I have used. If you watch my video to the Motorola Edge, I said that about that phone, even though it didn't even use the G variant. It was just a regular 765, and to me, it was faster than other phones I had that had the 765G. Well, the OnePlus Nord takes that cake by a big margin. And it's not just because of the G, because it's a 765G. Because again, I have experience with both. I've noticed very little difference. The Edge was faster than any of the 765 powered phones I had that were the 765G. The Edge, as you know, is just the standard 765. It had 6 gigs of RAM. And the OnePlus Nord right here just blazes right past it. This thing, it feels like a flagship, which the Edge does too. The Edge does too. I don't know if I'm more surprised that this has a plastic back or if the Edge has a plastic back. Because that phone is more gorgeous if you consider the waterfall display that it has. But this is more to my liking with the flat panel. I do wish it was a 21:9 aspect ratio. It doesn't have to be curved to have that. Obviously, the LG Velvet does it. The Moto G 5G Plus has a 21:9 aspect ratio without curving the screens like its sibling, the Edge and Edge Plus do. So this is, you know, but still, I do prefer this flat panel. It's definitely right up my alley. The phone is, I mean, it, you know, 12 gigs of RAM, y'all. Come on. For a mid-range chipset, this thing is blazing. I will have no problem using this phone as my daily. I mean, seriously. Because quite frankly, the only other, the only phones I'm interested in now are the, I want one of the upcoming gaming phones that has the Snapdragon 865 Plus chipset. And I also want to get my hands on the Redmi K30 Ultra with the MediaTek Dimensity 1000 Plus chipset. But this Nord, the thing of it is, a flagship killer was never defined a few years back when this whole phrase first came out. It was never coined as, you know, a flagship killer never just had to have the flagship processor to be a flagship killer, okay? You know, it could have the upper premium mid-range chipset and be a flagship killer. The problem is, we don't get a lot of devices, at least not here in the U.S., that ever have the upper mid-range chipsets. You know, these manufacturers, they're quick to use the latest and greatest, you know, flagship, the annual flagship from Qualcomm. But then when they come out with their mid-range phones, they don't give them the same treatment. They don't get the latest mid-range chipset. They get last year's mid-range chipset, even though its predecessor already came out. Luckily, because we had this big race to 5G this year, it's been going on since before the pandemic even happened, since the coronavirus was a thing. You know, and the only mid-range chipset that had 5G, you know, besides the offerings from MediaTek, which may or may not have even been out yet, was the Snapdragon 765. As a matter of fact, the MediaTek offerings weren't out yet because the first 765 power phone to come out came out January 4th. I remember ordering it. It was the Redmi K35G. And it became available on January 4th. And I ordered it, got it in, did a video on it. It was my first experience with the 765. The 5G didn't have the bands here for 5G to work. Even on the networks that where it was launched, like for T-Mobile. Of course, I didn't have it by the time AT&T launched it in my area. They launched it April 24th or something like that here in my area. But nonetheless, though, because of the race to 5G and the only other chipset besides the Snapdragon 865 that had 5G, you know, included was the 765 Snapdragon. And, you know, I mean, it was either that or use last year's 855 with the, you know, and include the 5G modem, or the 855 Plus and, again, include the 5G modem. But, you know, the 865 and 765 are, you know, there's a preference to those because there's not an option to take it away, put it in, et cetera, et cetera. Even though they say it's not built into the 865 like it is the 765, you might as well just say it is because you can't get the 865 without the 5G modem. So it makes no sense to even really go into detail anyways. Of course, there would be a benefit of better battery life if it really was built in like the 765, but that's for a different story. But because of that, because, you know, everything was, you know, 5G was put, you know, was an emphasis on everything. Everyone wants a 5G phone now. Everyone's racing to 5G. The carriers are rushing to launch the 5G networks. You know, it was either, you know, the Snapdragon 865 or Snapdragon 765, you know. So finally, we started getting a lot of devices with the premium mid-range offerings. Y'all remember a few years back when the OnePlus 3 came out, along with the ZTE Axon 7? They had the Snapdragon 820. At that same time, Alcatel released what many considered a flagship killer. It was the Alcatel Idol 4. And it had the Snapdragon 652 processor. And at that time, the Snapdragon 652 was the best processor besides the Snapdragon 820. If you couldn't get the 820, the 652 was what you wanted. But no one used it on this side of the world. You know, you had several 652-powered phones come out overseas from Xiaomi. But over here, the Alcatel Idol 4 was to my knowledge the only one that we got. I think Lenovo released that big phone with the AR capability the year after, and it had either the Snapdragon 652 or the slight successor, the 653. But that was a very niche product there that didn't get out into a lot of hands. It was just to showcase Google's AR technology. Sorry, that was my other phone going off there because it hurt my voice. That was my Edge going off in the background. But nonetheless, though, this is, to me, a flagship killer. The Motorola Edge, the regular Edge, the non-plus is a flagship killer. I mean, look at everything it brought to the table for half the price. I mean, literally, the only other thing the Edge was missing besides the 865 processor was wireless charging. Other than that, it had all of the same stuff. Because the Edge Plus doesn't even have a quad HD screen. It's full HD, just like the Edge. Same size. You know? And here we are with the OnePlus Nord. If I'm not mistaken, I know that the sensors aren't exactly the same, obviously, but, the OnePlus 8, if I'm not mistaken, had a triple setup in the back, whereas the 8 Pro had a quadruple setup. Y'all correct me if I'm wrong in the comments. I had the 8, but not the 8 Pro, and I don't remember the camera array on the back, but if I'm not mistaken, it was triple on the standard 8. This has 4 like the Pro. Now, granted, it's not the same 4, you know, but, I mean, and of course, the Pixel 4a, if y'all have already seen reviews for that, and there's tons of them, I won't get my hands on it until next week. That single camera blows the competition out of the water anyway, so it's really not about the lens count. But OnePlus has brought a lot to the table with the Nord for under $500. Some places, this phone is actually going to cost, $430 for the 8-gigabyte model, if I'm not mistaken. Right now you're gonna see a little inflation because people are gonna kind of charge you if you're trying to get it here in North America anyway, or the United States, I should say. You know, you're gonna have a little inflated price there because people want to make a little extra money on top of the extra money that they already make. They want to make a little bit more because, you know, they're technically doing the importing for you, so kind of adding that little fee there. But I mean, even at $500. The same price that the Edge was when it first came out. And of course, its price is already up to $700, so it's no longer $500. So you can't say that anymore. But even if it was, even if this and that were $500, I mean, it would honestly come down to more RAM. Do you want more RAM, or do you really like that waterfall display? Because heck, I got it right here on hand. Actually, as a matter of fact, you know. Speaking of which, let me just seriously. Seriously, you're either going to want that waterfall display, and it is gorgeous. There is no mistaking that. And it's a bigger screen, too. Or are you going to want, twice as much RAM? This has 6, this has 12. And even if this had 8, it'll still be blazing faster than this. Well, maybe not blazing, but you get the idea. I have to take blazing back because what oftentimes slows any phones down are these crazy skins that your manufacturers put on their phones. But as you know, Motorola and OnePlus, they're probably the best. They use the most minimalistic skins. I mean, their UI are near stock Android. You got Motorola's My UI, and then you have Oxygen OS. And I can't really tell you which one I favor, because today I might tell you Motorola, tomorrow I might tell you OnePlus. I always change my mind on that. I can't really say, honestly. They're both, you know, beautiful phones, absolutely stunning and gorgeous. I've really enjoyed using this Nord. I haven't even had it for 24 hours, but it's been fantastic. The thing is, I mean, I don't remember my OnePlus 8 being any faster, honestly. I mean, I'm sure it was, you know, I'm not going to get technical, but this phone is just amazing. The Pixel 4a has a Snapdragon 730. And people have raved about how fast it is, that you can't tell it's not a flagship by how fast and fluid it runs, and obviously by the camera quality that phone is putting out. It's the best at stills. It's not quite the best at video, they say, but the same reviewers have raved about the video. They said, you know, it may not be the best at video, but it is definitely one of the best at 350, and it already takes the best stills. You know, and they said that they haven't had any performance hiccups, you know, in the phone with the 730. This has the more powerful 765G at that, you know. The OnePlus Nord has been fantastic. It's really, really feels good in the hands. I mean, it feels right. It's perfect. It's the perfect size. I absolutely love the build quality of this phone. I have no problem with that plastic back. It looks glass. It feels almost glass. I mean, it's beautiful. It's less of a fingerprint magnet, honestly, than the Edge is. I mean, you're getting all of the things you could possibly want out of a flagship. Let me not say it like that, because I know a lot of people, they want wireless charging. A lot of people do expect, you know, a headphone jack or a micro SD card slot. But for this price, you know, you have to remember, Qualcomm has consistently gone up on their processors' prices since the Snapdragon 835. When the Snapdragon 835 came out, their prices started climbing, and they've climbed every single year. They're already saying that next year the 875 is going to cost more than the 865. The 865 went up higher than the 855, which, you know, exceeded the 845. And, of course, you already know where I'm going with this. You know, a few years back, the 820 didn't cost more than the 810, you know, a year later, you know. Just to, you know, kind of give you an idea, the 810 wasn't much... It wasn't really that much higher than the 805, which, you know, the 805 wasn't higher than the 800. You know, you get where I'm going at with this. So that's why they have to raise their prices, because Qualcomm raises the chipset prices, and then they have to make their own profit. Xiaomi offers their phones for so cheap, because if you actually go back and read from a couple years ago, the CEO has actually stated that they make their phones for the people, and they have a very small expectation and profit, if you will. But not every company's going to operate like that. They can't, you know. I mean, if I'm in the business of making phones like this, I want to make some money. I mean, it is what it is. Let's be real. Qualcomm's got to make their money. You know, what it is it's not even just Qualcomm's fault either. The advancement in mobile technology is just speeding up faster and faster nowadays. You know, these chipsets keep being made on smaller and smaller processes. You know, we're fixing to get into the 5 millimeter process nodes, you know, in December. You know, when Huawei introduces the Mate 40 series, you know, the last Kirin. I think it's the Kirin 1020 or something like that. It's going to be built on a 5 nanometer process. Actually, before that, I don't even know why I even went that far. September, October, when the iPhone 12s come out, or the iPhone 11s, whatever Apple decides to call their next generation iPhones, they're going to have the Apple A14, which is going to be based on a 5 nanometer process. You know, you already know the Snapdragon 875 will as well. MediaTek's working on one already too. So I mean, it's just a matter of time. You know these. Well, it's not a matter of time of anything. I'm over here arguing with myself, y'all. I'm sorry. It's just these smaller nodes are making these even higher to manufacture, you know, and the costs go up. So manufacturers like OnePlus, they're having to raise their prices of the phones that they used to be known, you know, that were known as flagship killers, you know, because they made a name for themselves now. People know who OnePlus is. T-Mobile sells out of OnePlus's devices often. Not this year because of the pandemic. This year is not a good example. But, you know, when they first started selling the OnePlus 6T, and then the OnePlus 7 Pro, and then the OnePlus 7T and the 7T Pro 5G McLaren, you know, these phones were selling out. Maybe not the McLaren, because it was a $900 phone, which people weren't used to spending on a OnePlus. You know, they would have at that time last year, they rather spend another $200 or $300 and get the Note 10 5G that T-Mobile was offering at the same time. Of course, I was partial. I still thought that at $900 the McLaren was a better buy. But you do have your people, you know, that when they see that Samsung name, it's like Apple. They're going to choose that over anything, you know. But OnePlus is picking up steam. They have been picking up steam. That's why their phones are over $1,000 now. And the Nord is, and you know, let's be real. We haven't seen a OnePlus phone cost under $500 in a few years now. Okay, so, you know, not one that has a Snapdragon 800 series processor. So you're not going to see that. It's not necessarily OnePlus's fault. They do kind of want to climb that ladder. They have become more of a premium brand. They've got that acknowledgement now. There's nothing wrong with wanting to move up that ladder. They're adding features that you don't typically find on flagship killers to make them true flagships. wireless charging, et cetera, just to name one. But they're able to churn out, you know, they're able to kind of go back to their roots with the Nord, with the 765 processor. And, it is what it is. It has 5G built in. So even though it's not the premium 800 series Snapdragon, you know, because it has 5G built in, and 5G is very new still, it's going to be new for a couple of more years. Even though it's a mid-range processor, it's a premium mid-range processor, which means you're going to pay a premium for it still. It's we can argue about it all day. Y'all wouldn't have liked this phone if it had a MediaTek chipset. When the OnePlus Nord, its history, before it was known as the Nord, it was known as the OnePlus Z. Now, by that time, it had the 765G Snapdragon processor. But before that, it was known as the OnePlus 8 Lite. And it was supposed to come out with the 8 and 8 Pro. And at that time, it had the Dimensity 1000L chipset. And I'm going to tell you something. The Dimensity 1000L processor would have actually been better. It would have been way faster than this device already is. And it would have cost it the same. It would have cost it the same and would have been almost twice as fast. The Dimensity, well, not twice, you know, if you're looking at Antutu, it kind of depends what benchmark you're looking at. But the Dimensity 1000L blows the Snapdragon 765G processor out of the water. In fact, if you check out my video for the Redmi 10X 5G that has a Dimensity 820, that blows the Snapdragon 765G out of the water. Personally, I would love this phone even more if it had the Dimensity 1000L. It would have been the same price, way faster. But people here in the United States, for some reason, they're not crazy about MediaTek. MediaTek is like a cancer to them when they hear it. See? But why do you think companies like Blue are able to come out with their, you know, proclaimed flagship that has wireless charging and has all of the other goodies that you want? Except a Qualcomm processor, because they use MediaTek, and they're able to offer these phones for $300. That has every single box marked except the Qualcomm processor. Personally, if this thing had a Dimensity 1000L, I'd make this video twice as long, and I've already made it long enough. But I hope y'all enjoy it. Again, OnePlus Nord, 12GB model. That's the blue variant here. Very nice phone, blazing fast. I hope y'all have enjoyed this video. Sorry it's so long. I know y'all are probably going to go off on me in the comments. It's all good, though. I appreciate everybody. And I will see you on the next one. Peace.